Hello. We're going over the quiz on derivatives in this installment of alternative delivery for the 24th of March. As you're doing this, you are going to be marking this. You may want to pause to check your work and compare notes and evaluate how many points to give yourself on certain problems. I will advise you of my own rubric. And the spirit of this whole thing is that teaching and learning can continue unabated even during times of unusual circumstances like this. And that is, in fact, my primary objective. Assessment is a secondary but a necessary objective. To that end, I do have plan A, which is that we get back together and I do finish the term, giving you some tests and things like that. But I also have a plan B just in case we don't come back, and I'll share that as needed when the time arises, if the time arises. But in both plans A and plan B, relative to assessment, grades are being earned and will be rendered. And so if you have goals that depend on completing this course this term, your goals can remain intact. This quiz counts if I get your feedback, otherwise it's zero, so make sure that you do send me the score that you earned on the test. I will say more things about the rubric, but in general it's 10 points per numbered problem. Divide your total by 150, since there were 15 problems, to get a percentage. So here's the first problem, and I'm going to tell you that this is the way I'll grade the problems dealing with evaluating derivatives at a point. I would look at the derivative. If you got the derivative correct, it will be 8 points out of 10 earned right there. And if you get the number correct, you would earn the final 2 points about doing the arithmetic. So here you find the derivative, and the evaluation is 0 when you put 13 in for x. Here's number 2. This is using the quotient rule. Again, you have to get the derivative completely correct for full credit. If you get that correct, you will get 8 points, and then the number counts. So in this case, you can see the derivative is shown there, and we should get minus 5 over 4. You don't have to have it simplified the same way I do, but it must be the same algebraic expression. Here's number 3. This involves the constant rule, the product rule, and the chain rule. We're evaluating this at minus pi over 12. Again, this is a kind of problem I probably would ask, and you don't need to have a calculator in order to do this problem. So there is the derivative, and there is the number that we get. You can check if you have the number written differently. That certainly can be okay. This one is implicit differentiation. Again, the derivative has to be correct, and then we plug in numbers to get the number of minus pi over 3. This one is the product rule, but we're using the exponential and arc sine function. And we're evaluating this when x is equal to 0. The answer should be 3. Here is the quotient rule involving the logarithm function and, of course, the chain rule. So you do the calculation, getting the derivative, and the answer is 1 minus 3 natural log of 2. You could write that as 1 minus natural log of 8, and there's different ways you could have written it had the same number. Here I ask you to use the limit definition to find the derivative. I would give you no credit if you didn't evaluate the derivative this way, because you wouldn't be following direction. So your first step does have to start out with this limit kind of statement, and you work through the algebra and you get minus 1 at the end of the problem. Number 8. This is the chain rule involving the tangent function. So there you can see your derivative, and you can figure out what the slope is. And so we have the slope and intercept. In this, the derivative would be 5, and the slope would be 2.5, and the intercept would be 2.5. This problem, number 9, is about implicit differentiation and explicit differentiation. There are 3 parts. I would count each part for 3, and then you have another point there that you can use if you want to award yourself that point as well. So whether we do implicit differentiation or explicit differentiation, we get 7. So 3 points for each of those, and then you get 3 points for the answer to part C, which is 2. This is a word problem about a ship. We can see that the picture is worth something. If you drew a proper picture, that would be worth, I suppose, some partial credit. And then you have to use a Pythagorean theorem. And you do implicit differentiation. And you plug in the numbers from the snapshot in time. You get minus 94 over 13, or some other fraction. Some students sometimes don't reduce a problem like that. Number 11, the answer is that x0 is minus 1 and y0 is minus 8. Give yourself 4 points for each of those numbers, and that leaves 2 points that you can award yourself if you did some quality work elsewhere. Number 12 is dealing with velocity, acceleration, and so on and so forth. There are 5 parts. Each one is worth 2 points, and the unit is worth a half point each time. The signs matter, so the position is at minus 20 feet for A. The velocity is also negative. It is minus 27 over 2 feet per second. Those are the units. The acceleration is going to be plus 6 feet per second squared. The direction changes at 2, or if you believe in negative time, you could say it changes at minus 1/2. And part E is, I said 31 units, that should be 31 feet. Number 13, I ask you to argue why this function has exactly one root. So it's a continuous function, and it is negative at one point and it's positive at another, so by the intermediate value theorem there's at least one root between the two. If you consider the derivative, where it is increasing and where it is decreasing, you can conclude that there is only one root. And I ask you, what is that root? And that root is x equal minus 4. You can find that from the rational roots theorem that you learned in your pre-calculus, among other things. So x equal minus 4 is for B. I count these each to be 5 points. Here's a graph, and I do expect you to verify all of these things happen in order to get credit for this. So you have to have written a continuous function, or it's minus 1. The function must be defined on all of minus 10, 10, or that's a minus 1. The function must be decreasing at minus 5, but the y-coordinate at minus 5 has to be positive. It must be increasing at 5, and the y-coordinate at 5 has to be negative. There must be an abrupt change of direction at the point 3, so the derivative doesn't exist. The function has relative maxes and mins at minus 7 and 6, and it is concave up at minus 7, and it is concave down at 6. Number 15, since the function I demanded was continuous on a closed interval and has opposite signs at minus 5 and 5, there's at least one root from the intermediate value theorem. There could be more. Mine had 4 roots.